सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा शारदा शारदाम्बुजे वदना वदनाम्बुजे सर्वदा सर्वदास्माकं सन्निधिं सन्नितिं क्रियात् श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करं लोकशङ्करं सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् भारती करुणापात्रं भारती पदभूषणं भारती पदमारूढं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारतीं सद्गुरु चरणारविंदाभ्यां नमः। डियर गुरु बंधुस एंड ऑल द फॉलोअर्स ऑफ द शंकर गुरु परंपरा, अ हार्टी वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू टुडे। We are almost at the concluding week of the Chaturmasyam and the talk series as well. So we welcome you on behalf of Sringeri Guru Bandhava and Tattva Loka. Adi Shankaracharya in his Prashnotra Ratnamala says, who is said to be the supreme goddess? Kacha Paradevata Utta. Who is this supreme goddess? He says none other than Chitshaktihi, the consciousness power that is Amba. No wonder he did the pratishthapana of Brahma Vidya Surupini by drawing the Sri Chakra Yantra on a rock. To this day and forever, that Goddess Sharda's Brahma Vidya Surupini is seated on that same rock and same yantra that was drawn by none other than Jagadguru Adi Shankara himself. There are quite a few places he did the Sri Chakra Pratishtha as well. So Nagaryam Kanchi, Kancham Sri Chakra Pratishtapana, we just utter that Ashtotra in the Shankara Ashtotra Nama. And he did a Pratishtapana of Sri Chakra in Nepal in a place called Guhyeshwari. It's a Shaktisthala and it is behind Pashupatishwara actually. And also in Badrinath, Sri Chakra Pratishtapana took place. And in Guheshwari, we do see that, you know, inscriptions in, some of the, at the doorstep rather. So, since Adi Shankara's time, we have seen this Sri Vidya Upasana. Sri Vidya Upasana culminates in all the three actually. Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, and Jnana Yoga together. And it's a stream of its own, although it is also part of Shaktam. And taking the cue of this Guheshwari, where the Sri Chakra Pratishtapana took place behind Pashupatishwara in Nepal, our Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswamiji did the same thing in Karur. Not many people would be aware of this. In Karur, there is Ishwara temple. It is called as Pashupatishwara. And he recalled that Pashupatishwara of Nepal and said, In this Sringeri mud branch in Karur, we should be doing Pratishtapana of Rajarajeshwari. So he gave a Swarna Sri Chakra Yantra and the Pratishtha was done by our Jeshta Mahasanidhanam. So in very few places we have Amba's Rajarajeshwari, and generally it is our Paddhati to do only Shardamba in the Sila Rupam. But in Karur, it's a very famous, with 12 bhujas, Dwadasha bhuja, in all the three goddesses, Mahakali, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswati, Atmaka, Sri Sharda Devi. So using that, and when he sort of, asked for this sculptor to sculpt Rajarajeshwari, he gave a Dwadasha bhuja to that Rajarajeshwari Rupa actually there. So such is the greatness of our Sringeri Peetam, where all the pratishtas that we do are Vedic and all form part of the Sri Vidya worship by installing the Sri Yantra where the Amba is seated. So today with us, we have Dr. Chandrasekhar Ji Thekal, who is a Sri Vidya Upasi himself for the last 25 years. And he got this Diksha from none other than Sri Shankara Shastrigal, who did the Pratishtha of our Bangalore Matha Sharadamba of Bangalore Matha. So generally sort of people go asking for Diksha. In this case, Shankara Shastri girl was passing through his house and then not known to him at all. And he just came into the house and said, you know, tomorrow I'm going to give this Diksha to you. And that's how he got the Diksha. And he's been doing the Navavarna Puja almost all Purnamis and in a grand manner on Navaratri days, on all the 9 Navaratri days. So we have the right person to interpret the Namas of Lalita Sahasranama of Lalitamba, Lalita Parameshwari. So we invite Sri Dr. Chandrasekhar ji to take us through and enlighten us with the Mahima of Lalita Parameshwari. Thank you. Over to you, Doctor.
Om Sharada Sharadam Bhuja Vadana Vadanam Bhuje Sarvada Sarvada Smakam Sannidhim Sannidhim Kriyat Shruti Smriti Purana Namalayam Karunahalayam Namami Bhagavat Pada Shankaram Loka Shankaram Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः वन्दे मातरमम्बिकां भगवतीं वाणीरमोमात्मिकां कल्याणीं कवनीयकल्पलतिकां कैवल्यधामेश्वरीं वेदांत विज्ञान प्रतिपाद्यमान विभवां विद्वन मनोरंजनीं श्री चक्रांचित रत्न पीठ निलयां श्री राजराजेश्वरीं। मई श्रद्धा भक्ति पूर्वक साष्टांग नमस्कारम स्टु उभय जगद्गुरुस्। The topic taken today is Lalita Sahasranama, the essence of Veda and Vedanta. So it's a very, very, very vast topic. Lalita Sahasranamam is a very vast topic. This was handled for almost about a year once. I will try to concise the entire thing in about 2 hours allotted. So I will not go into each nama as such. It is practically not possible. But I will try to bring about all the aspects what has been told in the Veda generally and Vedanta, and whatever has been told in Lalita Sahasranama is not different from what has been told in the Veda and the Upanishads. So first, today we will go through a complete summary of the entire Lalita Sahasranamam. We'll try to summarize the entire Lalita Sahasranamam. And then in the second session, I will try to fit in namas with respect to the topics that we have dealt, so that whenever we try to recite, so each nama, so we should be able to sort of concentrate and ruminate and do anusandhana of that particular nama of Devi with respect to the artha that has been told. So, see, in Vedas, it is very, very, very huge, as I said. So, for any grantha that you take, there is something called Anubandha Chatushtaya. What is Anubandha Chatushtaya? If you know about some topic, okay, the person who wants to know about that topic and whatever it is, once he starts coming, once he has an access to that, once he listens to that through a guru, it binds him into knowing about it in more detail and draws closer and closer towards the actual subject. Okay? Anubadhanati is Anubandha Chatushtaya. That is, Anubadhanati is, it binds, Anu is Paschat, which is later on, it binds him. Okay? Now, what is Chatushtaya? Anubandha Chatushtaya is for, what is it? One is the Vishaya, is the topic. Here the topic is Lalita Sahasranama. Okay? Now, second is, anybody, suppose I want to know about some topic, I have to know what is the use by knowing about it. That is the Prayojana. The first one is the Vishaya or the topic. Second one is Prayojana or the use. What is the fruit that I get out of knowing that particular topic? That is Prayojana. Third one is Sambandha. What is Sambandha? What is the relation between the Prayojana and the topic, which is me? What do I get? The Sambandha that I have with the topic and myself is the Sambandha that I get, which is the individual. And fourth one is the Adhikari. So, what is the basic criterion that one who has to fulfill to know this particular topic and to draw the fruit later on? So, these four, if I know, then it leads to knowing more about that particular subject. So, this, keeping these four, we will deal with the entire Lalita Sahasranama. So, what is the Vishaya? What is the topic? It is about Lalita Sahasranama. So, just to sort of just what is Lalita Sahasranama? It has three portions in it. One is Purvapitika, Madhyama, and Uttarapitika, or Phalashruti. There are about 320 shlokas in its entirety. So there is Purva, Madhyaman, Uttara Pitika, which is Phalashruti. It comes in the Brahmanda Purana Uttarakhanda. As has been told, Brahmanda Purane Uttarakhande. Okay. Then, from where did it originate? How? It has been told that it came out through the conversation between Hayagriva and Agastya. So as it says, Brahmanda Purane Uttarakhande Shri Hayagriva Agastya Samvade Shri Lalita Sahasranama Stotra Kathanam Nama Dvitiyodhyayaha. Okay? So it is basically the conversation between Hayagriva and Agastya, two Mahanubhavas, two stalwarts basically. Here, to understand the magnanimity of Lalita Sahasranama and how beautiful and how powerful it is. So when Agastya asks, am I not eligible? So Hayagriva takes him through a lot of tests and things like that, and then later on does the Upadesha to Agastya. So Agastya Maharshi also in the beginning says, if you have not told me about this, it means I don't satisfy the eligibility criteria of an adhikari. So just imagine, tasmad gopyatamad gopyam rahasyam bhukti muktidam. So it is gopyatamad gopyam. So it is the secrets of all secrets. It is the secret of all secrets. Which means it is about that Devi who is none other than Sakshat Parabrahma Swarupini, who bestows grace on anybody and everybody if all the rules and regulations that have been laid out correctly in the right way. Okay? So, Rahasyam Bhukti Muktidam is what it says. Both Bhoga. So, what is the Prayojana by knowing such an important thing what has been propounded? Now, if what is the Prayojana that I draw from doing Upasana of Lalita Parameshwari is both Bhoga and Moksha. So there is a shloka in Vamakeshwara Tantra, etc., etc., everywhere. It says, wherever there is moksha, there is no bhoga. Wherever there is bhoga, there is no moksha. But one who prays to Lalita Parameshwari, that is Sri Vidya Upasana, bhogascha mokshascha karastha eva. Which means, both bhoga and moksha are like to both the palms of the upasaka. So he will have both bhoga and moksha, which means it is what has been told in Taittiriya is a person, if he has to go attain moksha, he has to get an interest to follow the moksha marga. If he has to follow the moksha marga, if there is dukkha, if there is poverty, if there is illness, etc., he will never feel like attaining the paramananda sthiti of moksha. So, in Taittiriya Upanishad, it very clearly says that you should do proper karma first, then attain dhana, sampat, etc., etc., do karma through that, then gradually go to the moksha marga. So, a person who does the upasana of Lalita Parameshwari attains both iha loka sampat as well as moksha is what has been told in Lalita Sahasranam. Okay? Now, usually, who are the adhikaris to know Lalita Sahasranam? Okay? Now, there are four adhikaris, what has been told in Bhagavad Gita also. Artho jignyasur arthaarthi jnani cha bharatarshava. So, similarly, here also, who is an artha, who is an arthaarthi, who is a jignyasu, who is a jnani. Now, if you take the entire loka into consideration, now there are only, you can classify all astikas into four. Okay? Now, what is it? The first thing is artha. Who is an artha? Who is facing a kind of a difficulty in life? There are so many difficulties that a person will face. So that is artatva. So before getting any sukha, the reason why I'm not getting sukha is because there is dukkha, and I have to get rid of dukkha first. That is what, whenever you do a sankalpa, you say mama upatta samasta durita kshaya dwara shri parameshwara prityartham. What is a samasta durita kshaya dwara? That is durita kshaya. Is durita is all the kashta that you get, okay, which you have been facing in this life due to all the papas that what we have done in our previous janma. So only by praying to Parameshwari, first you have to get rid of all the artatva or all the difficulties that you are facing in the form of ill health or poverty, any other thing. Then what happens? By doing like that, only artatva will go. You will get rid of that particular difficulty or the problem. Then if you keep quiet, you become stagnated there itself. So what should I do? I should pray little more and more, because now that I have sort of gotten rid of my poverty, etc., etc., now I come to a stage where I have to obtain health. In the sense, now my fever is gone, but I have to be more healthier, not to fall sick again. Isn't it? So all the karma that I have done till now will only get rid of that poverty and things like that. When I say poverty, a kind of coming to zero, from -4, -3, -2, -1 to zero. Okay? Now, if I have to grow little more, then I have to do little more, which is +1, +2, +3 kind of a thing. Okay? Now, that is artharthi. Now, when you have to do artharthi, then you get more, you will basically have some wealth, you will be more, you have a good family, you will get good satsanga, etc., etc. Okay? Now, majority of the people, majority of the loka falls in this particular group, which is trying to get rid of dukkha and to attain sukha. So these are the only two things that usually people work for. Okay, even astikas, whenever they pray, the prayer is sort of directed towards getting rid of dukkha and attainment of sukha. Okay, so the third one is jignyasu. Jignyasu is a person who wants to know about this Devi, that is Paramatman, who is the Devi herself. That is, I'm really sort of so curious to know about this Devi who is continuously removing all that papa, what I have done, and bestowing her grace upon me. So slowly, my curiosity increases in to know her more and more. Now, that is jignyasu. Okay? Now, this jignyasu later on becomes a jnani. Okay? What is jnani? Now, a jnani is one who has understood the Devi by her tattva. Okay? By her tattva. That is, from artha and artharthi to jignyasi and jnani, the path that all these people take is from namarupa to tattva. That is the only way that is possible, and also what has been ordained in the Shruti. Okay? Whatever has been told in the Shruti is exactly what has been told in Dalita Sahasrana also. Okay? So I will With respect to Lalita Sahasranama, there are a few points that I would like to say today, because it, more so it is in English, so it is reachable to many more number of people. You see, many people have a wrong understanding about Lalita Sahasranama. So they say Lalita Sahasranama should not be recited by women. Lalita Sahasranama should be recited only after Upadesha, right? And there are many people who say Lalita Parameshwari is a Kshudra Devata, so on and so forth. These are all completely wrong. Okay? Now, we will gradually come to know as to what exactly does it say in each of the aspects. Okay? Now, coming to the importance of Lalita Sahasranama Stotra, as I told you, it comprises of all the aspects of Veda and Vedanta. Usually, when it comes to the Veda, it cannot be followed by anybody and everybody. Okay? There is a limitation when it comes to the Veda. So, with apara karuna, Bhagavan Vyasa, who has completely sort of summarized the entire Veda and Vedanta in Ashtadasha Purana, has again done the same thing of bringing about the entire gist of Veda, Vedanta and Brahmanda Purana also. And Lalita Sahasranama is a part of Brahmanda Purana. Now here, when I say it is about the Purana, one very, very important thing that we should know is, when it comes to the Adhikaritva, here, with respect to Lalita Sahasranama, it can be recited by anybody. That is, in Chaturvarnya and Ashrama, it can be recited by anybody. So there is no specification that has been mentioned that only Purusha has to recite and do upasana and things like that. But in Sampradaya, what has been sort of propagated is there is a lot of technical detail when it comes to Lalita Sahasranama, because there is Stotra Parayana, there is a particular japa, there is upasana, there is homa khanda, there is dana, etc., etc., puja vidhi, etc., etc. Now, like how Vedas have a particular hymn and there is a notation, in Lalita Sahasranama also, the Sri Vidya aspect of what has been told in Lalita Sahasranamam, there are a lot of technicalities present in Lalita Sahasranama and Sri Vidya, where it is all fixed in the form of Bijaksharas. Bijaksharas, like for example, Hringkari Hrimati Hridyaheyopadeya Varjita, Kleenkari Kleem Hrim Aim, etc., etc. Okay, now these are all called Bijakshara. Now, what is a Bijakshara? Bijakshara is a vast meaning comprised and frozen in a particular Akshara. So it is like reciting that particular Bijakshara is the code to enter Bhagavati's prayer. Okay? So, by like how it is very important in the Veda, where there is a story where Vritrasura waged a war. There was a war between Devatas and Asuras, and Vritrasura does tapas. There is one Veda mantra where he recites Indra Shatrur Vardhasva. Is where he wants to say that the enemy of mine, who is Indra, need to be killed in this war. And he recites it in a little wrong way. Okay? So when he's reciting, there is a mistake. So what is his particular prayer is he wants Indra to be killed, obviously, because Indra is his enemy. But later on, it so happens that he gets killed. He himself gets killed. And in the end, he prays to Goddess and asks, what is the mistake that I did? Then Bhagavati Saraswati comes and tells him, you are a learned person. So you should know how the swaras, you know, go. Then it says, you see, by the way how you recited, it means that let the enemy of mine, Indra, kill me. And that is what has happened. Okay? So it is like that. So, similarly, even in reciting Lalita Sahasranamam or any other stotra, whenever you do with some kind of a kama, that is one sankalpa, we have to be very, 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 very careful in uttering or in doing uchara of the stotra. Because in Sanskritam, why I am sort of trying to emphasize on this particular Vishaya here is because it can be recited by anybody and everybody, we have to be more and more careful. Okay, so because there is no limitation, we have to be more careful. Okay, so it has to be learned from a proper guru who has come through the sampradaya. Now that is very, very important. Okay, so here, whenever you recite a nama, I might have a sankalpa, but whenever I'm reciting something, suppose I don't know Sanskrit, that is a different thing. Bhakti is important, all that is there. But what is important is not all of them will have the kind of bhakti that Bhagavati expects, isn't it? So, from our side, bhakti, shraddha, along with uchara, also is very, very important. We'll just give you an example. Whenever you say vandya, vandya, trijagadvandya, trimurtis, tridasheshwari. Okay. Now, here, vandya is, it is not, it is alpa prana vandhya. By mistake, what happens? You say vandhya in mahaprana. That is dhya, vandhya. Like how you say dhyana. Okay? When you say vandhya, it means to whom we do namaskaram. Okay? Vandhya. When you say vandhya, it means a lady who cannot beget children. So you see, it's totally opposite meaning. One who is Shri Mata, I am calling her infertile. Okay? Now that is so dangerous. So, because there was a time when somebody came and asked about the same thing, where they used to do a lot of Stotra Parayana about Lalita Parameshwari, and they wanted children and they never had. In spite of so much of treatment and doing so much of upasana also. And when we sort of probed, this was one of the mistakes. When you say Trijagadvandhya and you want a child, how is it possible? So it has a different meaning. So you have to be very careful. And when people fear Lalita Sahasranamam, it is because of this. And it is true also. So what happens if Veda mantra is recited wrongly, the same effect and same power is there in Lalita Sahasranama also is what I am trying to say. But at the same time, please remember that she is called Shri Mata or Mother. So you don't have to actually fear so much. All you have to do is to sincerely learn and pray, and you certainly she will bestow. Okay? With this kind of confidence, we will begin. Okay. Now here, all Purushartha Chatushtaya, that is Dharmartha Kama Moksha, all Purushartha Chatushtaya will be bestowed for any bhakta of Lalita Parameshwari, and that is guaranteed. Why? Purushartha Pradapurna Bhogini Bhuvaneshwari, Purushartha Pradayai Namaha. That is, she will bestow right from dharma to artha and kama and moksha. If you simply are not a dharmic person, for example, but simply you go on praying to her, then what happens? Then dushta durayai namaha, durachara shamanyai namaha. So first she removes all the durachara and dushta sangha that you have, and then she brings you into following dharma. And once you start following dharma, all the sankalpas or kama that you have will be according to dharma. Once you get dharma yukta kama, you will get artha in accordance with dharma and kama. If you are following dharma and kama and artha according its complete surrenderance, then she will also bestow mukti in the end. So that is Purushartha Pradayai Namaha. Why will she bestow everything? Because she is Purnayai Namaha. What is Purna? Purna is, she is complete. She is complete. Now what is mean? What is the meaning here by complete? Completeness. It is a kind of karya karana ananya. That is, she is the Parabrahma Swarupini manifested as the entire Jagat herself. That is, she is complete. There is no lacuna at all in her. Because if there was a lacuna, as how it is in us, then there is always a want to fulfill that. Because she is Purna, she is Purushartha Pradayai Namaha. Till what extent? Till the extent of giving mukti also. What is mukti? Mukti is becoming Parameshwari herself by tattva, tattva jnana. Okay? So, for that, all that is required is Bhakti Priyayai Namaha. Only if you simply start following Sampradaya, what has been told, you should always stick to Sampradaya, which is very, 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 very important in praying to Lalita Parameshwari. Okay? There, if you follow Sampradaya, what has been told, then with Bhakti, she will simply bestow any of this. Okay? So, Bhakti Priyayai Namaha. Okay? So, now coming to, since it is a stotra, even women should recite and can recite. Okay? But never ever without the guidance from a guru. So she is the guru herself in the form of a guru in the physical form who has come as per the Shastric tradition, which is Sampradaya. Sampradayeshwari Sadhvi Guru Mandala Rupini. Sampradayeshwari. What is Sampradayeshwari? Now, Sampradayeshwari is, what is Sampradaya? Samyak Pradaya. That is, properly propagated according to the tradition as is without compromising. Now that is sampradaya. What is Ishwari? Ishwari, sampradayeshwari, one who always controls the sampradaya. That is, if you commit a mistake, she will whip. She will, you know, whipping. Okay. Now, because she is a mother, she knows how to take care of her children. Whenever you do it with bhakti priya, she becomes bhakti gamya. Whenever you do it with lot of bhakti priya, she becomes bhakti gamya. Okay. Now, she simply embraces the child. Okay. And whenever there is, you do a mistake, dushta, whenever you act like a dushta, okay, then immediately what happens? She punishes. Okay. Now, so it is very, very important to follow a guru properly. Okay. Now, it has been told that, I told you there is sukha prapti and dukha nivritti. Here, it can be followed. That is, Lalita Sahasranama or Srividya can be followed by either Purusha or Stri. But here, there is in Bhashya of Lalita Bhashya, of Bhaskara Raya writes very clearly that Nitya Naimittika Karmacharana Purvakam Sarvatra Devyabheda Bhavana. You see, this is extremely important. What is important? Nitya Naimittika Karmacharana Purvakam Sarvatra Devyabheda Bhavana. So, Devyabheda Bhavana. Nitya Naimittika Karmacharana Purvakam. So, there are few people who asked me long back. That is, they say, when you do Upasana of Sri Vidya, then you don't have to do anything. Okay? Then you don't have to do anything. You simply do Upasana of Sri Vidya, that is enough. No, it is not possible. That is not what has been told. That is, what is Nitya Karma Charana Purvakam? For an Upanita, for a person who has been initiated into Brahmopadesha, that is a Brahmana, he has to perform his Nitya Karma and then do the Upasana of Lalita Parameshwari. And without that, how much ever japa, etc., etc., is a big zero. As far as the person who is initiated into Brahmopadesha, if he does the Upasana without Nitya Karma, it is a waste. At the same time, there are a few Nitya Karmas what has been told even for Stri. Now, let us not go into details of those. Even for her, she has to follow her Nitya Karma and then get into this particular kind of Upasana. But both Purusha and Stri are eligible for this particular prarthana. Okay. Now, whenever we take Sahasranama as a whole, as prarthana, see this prarthana, as I told you, there is Nama Sankirtana, Stotra Parayana, Japa, Puja, Homa, Ityadi. All of these are there. Okay. Now, there are a lot of technicalities and limitations when it comes to all these aspects. I remember my guru telling me about Sri Vidya, because as I have sort of alerted you that it comprises of Bijaksharas and it is the Shakti, the feminine form, though it is lot of Karunarasa and Matra Vatsalya, because of Shakti Swarupini, it is any mistake because she doesn't want you to make a mistake and then suffer, there is a whiplash that is given if there is a mistake. Now, it is only to correct yourself that this kind of a punishment is given. But what many people have thought is they try to adopt one aspect of Sri Vidya where it is Tantra Yukta, that is Tantra Shastra. What does it mean by Tantra Shastra? There's a completely technical way of using a mantra, yantra, and the tantra in one form of executing the puja aspect. Now, it is true that by following the tantric aspect of Sri Vidya, the phala is very, very quick. But we should always remember what this is. Antarmukha samaradhya bahirmukha sudurlabha. Bahirmukha sudurlabha is whenever we take the, because usually when it comes to Lalita Sahasranama, it is not just the Lalita Stotra Sahasranama Stotra Parayana. Nowadays, the trend is that everybody wants to sort of take Sri Vidya, Upadesha. Okay? So, Sri Vidya Upadesham or any Upadesham for that matter, I just have to recollect one incident has been told by somebody to me, that somebody went to Jagadguru Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswamigal and asked for Bala Mahatripura Sundari Upadesham. Then Jagadguru said, no, it is not very easy to take an Upadesha of Bala Tripura Sundari because it asks for a lot of, you need to be very dedicated, there are a lot of new rules and regulations, etc. So let the time ripen, then we will see. Okay? Then that person probably asked, then it is okay, at least can you please bestow Shiva Panchakshari mantra? Jagadguru got very angry. Then he said, what do you mean, at least Shiva Panchakshari? As if you are trying to rate Bala Tripura Sundari on some place and trying to bring down Shiva Panchakshari because it is five aksharas and it is six aksharas. Okay? Then he said, no, you Upadesha is not possible. Okay? So, later on, he said, first, take care of your mother. She is not well. Okay? First, take care of your mother. She is not well. And when he said that, his fellow was shocked because Jagadguru, his mother had never come to Jagadguru. And due to some quarrel at home, he had gone out of the house. He was living separately, leaving his mother alone. Then he immediately rushed back and found that his mother was sick. And then he came back to Sringeri and took blessings from Jagadguru. And then he said, do Matra Seva first. That is the first thing. Now that will give you the eligibility criteria to do any Puja Vidhana or Japa Upadesha. Which means, as I told you, for a stree also, there are some Nitya Karmas. All these things fall under the category of Nitya Karmas. Okay. So, simply going behind an Upadesha, asking somebody, can you please give Upadesha, is not right. Because the Upadesha is something that is given. You don't ask for it. Whenever there is Bhagavat Kripa, automatically it happens. You simply have to keep praying to her. Then she will take you through that path very carefully. Okay? Now, in Purva Pitika, there is a vakya where it says, Shraddha Bhave Hani Smaranat, it says. What is Shraddha Bhave Hani Smaranat? If there is no Shraddha, What is Shraddha? It is Shraddha. If you break that particular word of Shraddha, it is Shraddha. What is Shraddha? Shradd means it is the truth. Now, what is the truth? First, the truth is complete belief about Astikyata. That is, there is Bhagavati as Paramatman herself. And then, whatever Bhagavati has told in the Lalita Sahasranama, that has to be completely accepted as is and is to be followed. No, that is Shraddha. Suppose there is Shraddha Abhava. What is Shraddha Abhava? That is, if there is no Shraddha, and if I simply, you know, recite it just like that, then it becomes Hanismaranat. There might be a Hani. That is, Bhashyakara there sort of alerts that if you don't do it out of no Shraddha, then there might be a Hani, there might be a danger. Now, this doesn't mean you have to be scared. What does it mean? You have to learn properly and then sort of recite. That is the thing. That is the intention behind this. Now, I would like to bring about a very important aspect of Lalita Sahasranama, where you see in Bhagavad Gita also there is, Krishna says, Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam tathaiva bhajami. That is, however I pray, with whatever bhakti, shraddha, how much ever bhakti and shraddha, in whichever way you pray, I will simply bestow to that particular extent. Okay? So, every person, right from artha to jnani, has to pray. Isn't it? So, in praying, there are three things. One, when it comes to artha and artharthi, we will classify these four into two. Artha and artharthi as one, jignyasu and jnani as one. We will first come to artha and artharthi. Okay? Here, what does Lalita Sahasranama say? That is, Dhyana Dhyatra Dhyaya Rupa Dharma Dharma Vivarjita. Dhyana Dhyatra Dhyaya Rupa. That is, a person who is doing Dhyana, the procedure of doing the Puja, Japa, Dhyana, everything, is also Bhagavati herself. Dhyatru, whoever is doing, is actually, that is, Sharira, Manas, and the Pratyagatma, all three are actually Lalita Parameshwari herself. But I don't know. Okay? She is also, all the Sharira, Manas, and Pratyagatma also are, it is not different from Lalita Parameshwari. Dhyana, Dhyatru. Dheya Rupa. What is Dheya? Dheya is, you see in Gita, how Krishna says in Vibhuti, all the Vibhutis of Paramatman is Dheya Rupaha. Dheya means that on which I can cognize and ruminate is Dheya. So, when it comes to Dhyaya, all the Namarupas, like how it has been told, for example, it says, Sindhurarana Vigraham Tanayanam Manikya Maulis Purattara Nayaka Shekharam Smitamukhi Mapi Navaksho Ruham, etc. etc. Now, that is why it is called as Dhyana Shloka. There, that particular Rupa or the expression of and the description of Bhagavati, the purpose is, it can be had as a dhyaya for me. That is, if I have a name and form and description, my manas can sort of cling on to that and ruminate on that particular rupa with other attributes. Okay. Now, you please understand what is this particular rupa and attributes as has been told in the shloka. It is not just a limitation. It is Sakshat Parabrahma Swarupini as this particular rupa which is in front of me. Isn't it? And though I don't know, she is everything. Okay? When she is everything, she is also present as the Sharira and Trigunatmika Manas, what is present in me, in this particular body-mind complex. Okay. Who is it so? I mean, it is so profound. It is so big. It sends a jitter in me when I simply come to know that Sakshat Lalita Parameshwari is residing me as my body. Okay? Now, how will I understand that actually even now, Lalita Parameshwari herself is my Sharira also, and she is controlling all the functional aspects of the human body and mind. If I have to have, what is the Shraddha that I told you about? I have to always believe that she is present here and controlling. It is my Ajnana and Ahankara that I separate this body from the Jagat, which is herself. Okay? So what do I do? I say, this is only me and this is all you, which is the Jagat is sort of looked upon as you and only this Sharira as me. Okay? This is out of avidya. Okay? So I have to understand, how is she present as this body? In what all forms does she come? I will tell you now. Okay? Achha. See, to understand and pray, what is my kartavya now? That I have to pray in order to get rid of dukkha and also to have the prapti of sukha, isn't it? So I should, dhyana dhyatra dhyaya rupa should never be forgotten. So if Lalita Parameshwari in the form of my own phala, how do I take the phala? In the form of health, in the form of money, in the form of house, in the form of bhoga, etc., etc., etc. Because she is Bhogini Bhuvaneshwari. The entire Bhuvana, all the objects is herself. Now, if I have to attain bhoga or sukha in a very healthy way, then the tool with which I have to perform my kartavya of praying, which is the sharira and manas, also have to be very, very pure. Now, what does it mean pure? It means I have to follow a particular kind of achara. What is that achara? It is called sadachara. So, what has been told in Lalita Sahasranama? Sadachara pravartika. What is sadachara pravartika? Sat acharam. Sat achara. What is sat? Sat means that which is there. What is there? It is Bhagavati herself. What is the achara that she has told? It is as has been told in the Veda, that she has also told in Lalita Sahasranama. What has been told? You see, one, if you have to escape out of tapatraya and attain ahlada, tapatraya agni santapta samahlada na chandrika. That is, tapatrayagni santapta. All of us are sort of in boiling in tapatraya. What is tapatraya? Adhyatmika, adhibhautika, and adhidaivika tapatraya. We are all boiling in that tapatraya. If we have to come out of that tapatraya, samahladana chandrika, she gives ahlada. Okay, ahlada is she will remove you out of this tapatraya, provided you have sadachara. Okay, now what is sadachara? How is she present in all the different forms of tissues present in the body as nava avarana, in shat chakra, in trikuta, etc., etc.? All those details, along with the Vedantic aspect, where a jignyasu becomes a jnani and attains moksha, will be dealt in our next session. I conclude this session here.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for your enlightening elucidation of some of the namas and setting the stage for us to understand who are competent to learn and how to go about in learning. The one who wants to attain all the four purusharthas are competent enough, and how to learn this properly and with bhakti and shraddha to attain the benefits of all these things, very well explained by you. And we look forward to the next session, and we conclude this session today. Thank you so much, Doctor. Thanks, all of you. And tomorrow we have Chaturmasya Guru Vandanam program at 6:30, and a special address by our administrator, Sri V.R. Gauri Shankarji, will be presented. So please join us tomorrow at 6:30 for the Chaturmasya Guru Vandanam. So it's always our tradition to do this at the end of the Chaturmasya. And we are bringing ourselves to the Guru Bhavanam and doing this in front of Acharyas. That's the feel that, you know, we should have it in our mind and also in our Shraddha. And let's take it forward with the blessings of the Ubhay Jagat Gurus and Jagat Mata Shardamba. Thank you.